Most of you know that I spent my life being involved in research on two major issues, gender and the career development of talented people. That has led me to many unusual places. Early in my career, when I was with Nuket in Iowa City, I had the opportunity to study and to provide psychotherapy to artists and writers, writers at the Iowa Writers Workshop, with Nicholas Colangelo, conducted interviews with the 30 most patented inventors in America. Later on, I was the therapist in residence for the Frank Lloyd Wright School of Architecture in Scottsdale, Arizona. And throughout my career, I've had the opportunity to not only study highly creative people, but to be right in there with their lives, no matter how messy they might be. I have studied all the sorts of issues that impact creativity. Most of you know that my major thrust with regard to individual variables regarding creativity has been in the area of personality. And that's because once we get to the level of adolescents and adults, the groups that I work with, the best manner of prediction identification is past accomplishments. By the teen years, many creative people already have creative accomplishments, and by adult time, of course, they have. And so I focused upon personality variables that stabilize around 16 years old and focused upon accomplishments, which are good prediction of future accomplishments. So if you're wondering why I have not been a major user of Torrance tests, because I haven't worked with children. If I worked with children, of course I would use the Torrance tests to identify them. But they've been very useful for concurrent validity. So I'm going to take you through that journey. The mission of my career, and I'm very much mission-driven, can be summed up like this. Paul Torrance once said that once you fall in love with an idea, that idea will carry you. And that's been the truth for me. 35 years ago, I fell in love with the idea of making the world a safer place for creative people. And that meant creative people of both genders, well, all genders, I should say now, the full spectrum of gender, as well as for understanding how privilege intersected. So the mission of my whole career and now continues to be first finding those creative people wherever they might be. My interest in adolescence involves exploring new holistic ways of identifying adolescents who are capable of outstanding creative accomplishments as adults, guiding, providing career counseling for creative students that integrates comprehensive assessment, visioning, and information about invisible pathways. For a long time in vocational psychology, we've known that effective outcomes, that is, happy, satisfying lives, are dependent upon students having accurate information about themselves, normative information about themselves, having accurate information about the world of work, as well as the kind of counseling and mentoring that makes the connection, that bridges, makes the bridge from the student's abilities, interests, values, personality to the kind of work. That poses a special problem in creativity, as you know, because many of the careers that our students will have not yet been invented yet. In addition, careers that creative students enter have invisible pathways. Those of you who are artists know that one doesn't train to be an artist and enter an arts career like one does a career in law. They are non-linear pathways. And although there are some standardized steps, such as the building of a portfolio, or for a musician, the building of a repertoire, or for an inventor, the mastery of particular skills related to materials, tools, and methods in their area, those are standard. Nevertheless, the pathways are invisible. Sometimes they involve college, sometimes they don't. And so guiding young people means Having counselors and psychologists who are well aware of those invisible pathways, as well as being aware of the nonlinear way in which it does. Being a good counselor to creative people assumes that we not only use convergent methods of bringing objective information to bear upon the situation, but divergent methods as well that involve the intuitive integration and the imagination to fulfill a career. Recently, my career involved gathering creative people together for mutual support and inspiration, because we know that creativity truly does depend upon social support, and that the lone achiever is pretty much a myth. And finally, at least in the United States, many schools, many cities, many rural areas have become hostile places for creative people. This is in an anti-intellectual society. It is hard for creative people to find those places in which they can create. And so the role of people who want to support creative people must involve, to a certain degree, placemaking. So there are two programs I'll talk about. First, the Counseling Laboratory for the Exploration of Optimal States. That's Project CLEOS, which I began 9 years ago now at the University of Kansas. I want to stress again, I like to do programs that are not based entirely upon federal funding or any kind of funding that can go away. So although my chair came with an endowment, I knew that during bad economic times, endowments have a funny way of dwindling away. And so I was determined that anything that I create be self-sustaining. The Counseling Laboratory for the Exploration of Optimal States is self-sustaining. Anytime you create a program like this, you must find that sweet spot of affordability, and students pay $35 for all of the guidance they receive. Affordability, so that's the sweet spot. Can it be affordable, as well as sustainability of your organization? So one way that you can accomplish these kinds of programs is by integrating research, service, and training in one place. At the Counseling Laboratory, we do research, and that research has involved the validation of our profiling methods. They are, in some ways, similar to the profiling strategies that you were introduced yesterday. You learned about a profiling method that is being used in Paris. However, we use, for our profiling, we use holistic vignettes to help teachers to recognize what creative young people might look like. And you'll see how those vignettes were created. We explore the correlates of underachievement, creative accomplishment. We're not just interested in underachievement, we're interested in extraordinary creative accomplishment. We're also interested in performance anxiety, since that seems to block particularly musicians and performers, and creative block that stops people from their achievement. We also study the outcomes of counseling interventions in quasi-experimental studies using weightless controls. And most recently, we begin to study the effects of EEG biofeedback for flow consciousness. Because now that commercial headsets are readily available, we began 3 years ago by hacking toys, EEG toys, to be Bluetooth, and we hacked them to include software that enabled us to create graphic presentations. We now can actually buy headsets for under $100 that, for the purposes of biofeedback, provide excellent, just really great information to people about flow states, once we did the research to discover what flow states looked like in a variety of domains. We provide service, direct career counseling for creative adolescents and adults. We have now taken 1,000 creative adolescents and young adults through our program. We do perform performance anxiety interventions, which we're just now testing. And we do creative block and procrastination treatment. We've hit a lot of blocks in our creative block program. You know why? Procrastinators don't show up. Procrastinators sleep late. You have to have your programs held at, you know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon when they wake up. So, we've had a few problems there, but we're working on it. Individual counseling, group visioning, goal setting, and finally, EEG brain hacking for flow identification. We provide training, and that is to pre-service counselors and psychologists. As of this last year, all of our master's and doctoral students experience a one-semester practicum on-site in our clinic in which they learn methods of counseling creative people. Now, many of our students come there. We do have students who come because they want to learn about eating disorders or they want to learn about anxiety, and we always say, hey, you know, if it's a creative population, you'll get to see all of that, really. But what we've learned over the last few years is that our psychologists and counselors are doing very well in the job market, going to work for the Grammy Foundation, working with musicians, working at art institutes, music conservatories as therapists, and going on to have practices with creative people. So, yes, you can train counselors and psychologists in these skills, and they will get jobs. We also train in-service teachers to understand the needs of creative people and mental health providers to understand creative people. So you're going to see a lot of Barb Kerr in that, but that's not my fault. I'm sorry. We have one of the photographers at our Makerspace does this, so we do counseling for creative careers. And that involves making invisible pathways visible. We provide accurate, state-of-the-art interest, personality, values, and assessment. And those assessment batteries are based upon our research where we tried a variety of different batteries. And we were testing different batteries to find out, again, the sweet spot. Where's affordability, okay? And where can we get together a battery of interest, personality, and values inventories that are valid and reliable, and that when brought together have strong predictive power. And that means really keeping track of your assessments and making sure that you're not adding in anything that has low reliability or that's the equivalent of a Facebook quiz. Whereas most psychologists are trained to identify and to diagnose psychopathology and deficits, we do strengths-based interpretations so that at our laboratory, even when people are interpreting the NEO5 factor and they run into, for instance, clear evidence of defensiveness, well, we'll name it. We'll say, okay, you have a tendency to be low in agreeability and to be somewhat defensive. And then we'll follow that up with what strength that is. We'll say, well, as a matter of fact, many creative people need thorns, and they need to have a pretty thick skin to handle the kind of criticism they get. So that's a very good thing. But be aware of how that's going to impact other people. If you're in the fifth percentile in agreeability, then 95 people in a room out of 100 will be more likable than you are. So that is the kind of feedback that we give. We try to make it strengths-based, though. These might be some danger zones you have, but here's how you can use that. We, from the beginning of the day to the end, we're connecting flow experiences to career choice. At the beginning of the day, we have the students talk. The first thing we do is define what flow consciousness is, that it is a consciousness state, that it's a state in which one feels at one with one's work, a consciousness state in which one forgets to sleep, to eat, to go to the bathroom. When we say to the young people, there's an activity that's so challenging and involves so much mastery of a specific domain, there's an activity that you do that you can start at 10:30, promise yourself you'll only do it for an hour, and you look out the window and it's dawn. And they all nod and go, yeah. We always make it clear this isn't junk flow, okay? This isn't watching TV. This is something that they are expert in and that's extremely challenging. They get it. They get it. And we have them share that with one another. Teachers are there, and I have to tell you that the teachers often, their mouth is open like this, because little did they know that this student has a rock band in the basement. Little did they know that this kid was inventing a new software for playing World of Warcraft just within the neighborhood. It's pretty exciting to see their flow experiences. Then it's very important that our counselors be trained in how to give information about advanced training, specialized colleges and institutes, creative cities and communities. We need to help these young people to find their safe harbor, okay? To find their safe harbor. Isn't that what you want for all your children? You want them to arrive at that place where their talents will be recognized and where their particular personality will be appreciated. And so that means that our counselors need to understand what the colleges are, not the U.S. News and World Report ranked colleges, but where are their mentors? Where are their mentors for video game development? Where are their mentors to learn how to do art installations? Where are their mentors for people who are extraordinarily interpersonally creative and who create social action groups? Where can they find an opportunity to learn more and develop greater mastery in that field? We need to know that. We use Richard Florida's maps, the up-to-date maps of creative cities and communities, so we can take the person's personality and say, move to Nashville and you'll find a lot of people like yourself, okay? If you move anywhere but Silicon Valley, you're probably gonna cut your throat. So we really like to make sure people know where they're going to find people like themselves. Sometimes it's a big surprise. I've sat with kids who were verbally, intensely creative, amazingly good at languages and said, you're gonna find your peeps at the Defense Language Institute. And they'll go, join the Army, are you kidding? And I'll go, no, wait. Want to work with some people who are incredibly brilliant at learning languages? Okay. So a lot of times these kids have no idea where there are people like themselves. We provide guidance for lifestyle choices related to creative productivity. That's a nice way of saying we talk about how dumb relationships interfere with creative productivity and how often creative people get into stupid relationships. We talk about how creativity does not emerge out of substances. It emerges out of flow consciousness, expertise in a domain, and the persistent work toward work for the idea that one loves. And we also tell them about the research that shows that although many wannabe creative people have higher rates of substance use and abuse than the population in general, that actually practicing artists, writers, and musicians, okay, practicing people who make their living with their work have lower rates of substance use than a comparison group of community college adults, okay? So we try to bust those myths, about the wild creative artists. It's not all objective information giving. Because we know that creative people respond to what's called intuitive approaches, we have a powerful exercise that I've used for 30 years called the Perfect Future Day Fantasy, in which the group is a group of creative young people together in the darkness, adolescents lying together on yoga mats. Picture that. Got the picture. Visualize together a day starting in the early morning and going tonight, a working day, and everything that happens to them during that day. Now remember that these kids are extremely high in absorption and therefore they go into a visualization, almost a trance state, very easily, and they have vivid, extraordinary fantasies about the future that often have elements that were utterly unanticipated. Because I've been doing it for so long, I'm constantly getting, about once a week I get a Facebook post from somebody who says, you know that Perfect Future Day fantasy that I had about working in working in Alaska? Well, I'm teaching Inuit kids, And so the fantasies provide a frame that we think of, okay, there's the end point 10 years from now where you want to get. Now, what do we have to do today, this week, this month, this year, to get to that goal? Recognizing that it may change, but it's good practice. And then our newest program, if you look at the look of amazement on those young people's faces, he's wearing an EEG headset there. That's all it is. Got one sensor. If you're right-handed, it's over the left PFC. We turn it upside down to go to the right PFC. Otherwise, and then our hacker, our brain hacker, head of the team, he's a technologist who can transmit, who can transform brain waves into light and sound, created that thing there called the brain flower, which is a big graphic that where the color represents the particular area of the conscious spectrum where you are, alpha, beta, you know, theta, alpha, beta, gamma, and the radius of the arms of the flower, the petals of the flower, the radius indicates the intensity. So there, as you see, we have them on a large screen. You can see all the people gathered around here. Whenever we're doing this at a Final Friday art show, it just draws a huge crowd. Everybody wants to put on a headset. And now we have to deal with the fact that we get Bluetooth interference where we're running a lot of people all at once and all the Bluetooths, you know, are... That's our next technology issue. So here's some findings that we have so far. There's just so many, but here are some findings, some that are published, some that are in process. Our profiling study, some of you saw that in the Creativity Research Journal, showed that profiling creative students works for the identification of creative adolescents. Our underachievement study showed that many profiled underachievers had stronger creative personalities. That means more openness to experience. More creative values, stronger creative interests, and more accomplishments, more actual creative accomplishments on the creative achievements questionnaire than our achievers. And our gifted education selection study showed that grade point average was the major determinant of selection into a gifted program, but that personality, interests, and values played a part. We did quasi-experimental outcome studies that showed that the career workshops increased career exploration so that the young people continued to follow up on the careers they'd learned about. Engagement, and that was greater engagement, not only in the schoolwork, sorry, just the schoolwork related to their interest. You can't change everything. And intuitive decision-making. And our 5 to 7 year follow-up studies show that the majority of Clio students entered creative careers. Many of them were STEAM careers, you'll learn more about that in a minute, and self-created occupations. One of the first things we did using economic geography is we mapped creativity in Kansas by looking at all the NEO five-factor profiles and mapped the various creative strengths of cities in Kansas. We kept coming up with these creative clusters in places like Salina, you know, Derby, Kansas. What's up with that? Where are we finding all these creative people there? You know what we found out? Salina and this little town down here have an incredible art center, okay? That and sort of a renovated downtown that brings a lot of young people together. We're talking coffee shops, okay? So profiling works. How well do teachers know their creative students? Can they identify creative characteristics and behaviors? This is what we did. We gave teachers core profiles. Here's a core profile. I don't think I told you how we did it.
What age group
was that? 16. Okay, the profiles that we gave them, I need to tell you this. So in 2006 and 7, I and my graduate students did a comprehensive analysis of biographies of eminent people. No, not just those lists of the greatest white men, okay? Isn't that always the way it is? By the way, side note. Okay? Anybody who creates lists of greatest people nearly always finds themselves on the list. And I'm sorry, men, but it's such a guy thing to do. Women don't create greatest lists unless it's, you know, well, I'm not going to talk about that. But like, can we stop doing that? Can we just, like, stop talking about eminence in terms of, you know, men choosing men? Because that's, like, not okay. Right? If you look enough, you will find extraordinary women. You'll find extraordinary people. Creativity knows no boundaries. It cuts across ethnicities. And we should be good enough to find people in these areas. So we looked at eminent people internationally, across cultures and across sexes. And we created profiles, core profiles of what creative people look like. In addition to that, We used the literature, the wonderful literature that was given to us by IPAR, by the Institute for Personality Assessment and Research, the incredible literature that was created in the 50s, 60s, and 70s about the characteristics of architects, artists, writers. We know a lot about that. Why not use the research? No need to reinvent the wheel. Here's what we came up with. Creatively gifted students may be spontaneous, expressive, intuitive, and perceptive, with evidence of intellectual sophistication and childlike playfulness. They're very likely to be curious, open to new experiences, innovative in many areas of their lives. They may express originality in thoughts, are probably unafraid of what others might think of their ideas. Most likely, they have a wide range of interests and abilities, may be comfortable with ambiguity and disorder. They're likely to, oh, by the way, the wide range of interests and abilities means they're curious about a lot of things, but they always have a domain interest. They're likely to be unconventional, creatively gifted, imaginative, they challenge the status quo. They may have significant accomplishments in creative fields at a young age. Most of our students do, well, all of them. Many of these students may not have qualified for gifted education programs because of their concentration on their areas of interest rather than being well-rounded students. Do people hear Dr. Torrance's words here?
Yes.
It came up over and over again in our study of eminent people, that the fact that they generally concentrated on their area of interest and were not well-rounded students. We had to add that last line because the first year our principals kept sending us, in addition to the team of blue-haired and tattooed people, they kept sending us their model students as because they thought this was a privilege and that they needed to have good representative of their schools, and we said, please don't send them anymore. There's plenty of things for those kids. I mean, there's national merit, there's presidential scholars, there's Duke Tip. There's so many things for kids who get straight A's. I'm cool with them, okay? That's fine. But I'm not interested in that group. So this is how we developed it: biographical analysis, personality studies, and vocational personality descriptions. This would be an example of a domain profile we gave them of potential artists, architects, and designers. The student may have the ability to draw, model, use graphic software with technical skill, the capacity to create cartoons, paintings, photographs, videos, video games, sculpture, architectural models, and quality beyond their peers. He has a love of the visual world, dresses interestingly, they knew that was right away, and creates novel spaces around them. Like you people are creating novel spaces with your Legos. They have excellent grades in art, photography, design, graphic design, other courses emphasizing special visual ability. They have uneven grades. That's a polite way of saying they get A's in what they like and they can blow off everything else. And then their achievement scores. They're non-conforming. The art students are more often introverted than extroverted. Not always, but the modal art student is introverted. Sometimes prickly, nice way of saying low in agreeability, quirky, ironic in demeanor, expressive, they may be introverted, and yet expressive and deeply engaged in his or her art. Okay? Guess what? When we give teachers those profiles, they know that kid. How many of you artists saw yourself there? Any prickly? Any prickly? So we've then found that the personality, then we brought the kids in the laboratory. Like I said, we've had 1,000 of them now. And after getting these, just being identified by vignettes, the students, the mean scores on openness to experience, always 90th percentile and above, always. They matched the core characteristics of creative people on traits. They had high openness to experience, moderately low conscientiousness. The interest inventories yielded clear preferences for artistic and investigative interests. If you look at our modal student combines artistic and investigative interests. That means that they are interested in arts, literature, and humanities, but they're also interested in science and technology. And then they tend to go one way or the other depending upon gender and cultural context. But they're coming with similar interests, of integrative interests. So teachers were very effective in that. We also found that despite the fact that the primary role of teachers was as coordinators of gifted education programs, one-third of the students they profiled had never been identified as gifted or placed in any advanced program. Interestingly, before the profiling experience, many of the teachers had been unaware of the significant accomplishments as measured by the Creative Achievements Questionnaire of innovators in their schools, such as recording contracts, really, publications, small businesses, and gallery shows. And it's not because the teachers didn't care, because after all, these teachers had brought these kids here, right? They did care. It's just these kids keep such a low profile that many people don't know what they're doing. They're developing software in the basement. So this really did cast a wider net for talented students. Did I mention that we weren't comparing them to profiles of adult eminent people? We're comparing them to what eminent people were like at 16 years old.
I know you're looking for eminence in this, or, you know, on a framework of eminence, but what about the kids who are so beaten down by labeling that they don't have the chance to dig into their area, that they still have that, like, once you...
We find those. See, those are the kids. That's that one-third who never got into the gifted program.
But they don't have, like, say they can create video, but if the quality is not high, like, if you're not evaluating the product, but say they're, you know, creating video games or something like this, but may not look like they're getting their national award, but they still have those.
Oh, no, we're not looking at national awards. Thank you for asking me to clarify that. We're looking for community or regional, so that... These are kids who have rock bands that are playing in the local, you know, all-age places. It's, yeah, we're not looking
but it's
for...
But like, but what if they haven't had the chance to sort of, you know, do that? Like, someone hasn't really noticed that or helped them along?
A lot of teachers tell us that it's not the... Well, they don't. The teachers don't know about the creative accomplishments. The teachers are choosing them mainly on personality characteristics.
Yeah.
So they're finding them based on what the kids... The whole of what the kid looks like, seems like, they go, she
okay,
has...
A way to ask. So it can be a deep interest versus a high-quality product.
Right.
Okay.
Right. It's more likely to be a deep interest than a high-quality product. I'm just making the point that we have kids who have, we do have these kids, but no, not most of them, or don't have recording contracts. It just, it's extraordinary that the point here was that they have recording contracts that nobody knows about. Sometimes not even their parents. Like when my daughter told me that she was, at 15, that she was going on a road trip with her band. I said, what band? What road trip? Who's going? You're 15. And suddenly I was reliving that mother's role in Almost Famous. I was like, okay, you're going to sing, and I want to see the costume that you're going to wear. I want the number of the people you're... Yeah. I really didn't know she actually booked a trip across the country.
Where'd your book?
So one of our most interesting studies, we found that creative underachievers were on most of the scales. And this is where you have to really watch out about the nature of the curve, the predictive curve, the curve the correlation between personality traits and creative productivity, because the underachievers were actually higher on artistic. So you can't just look at ceiling scores. They were, though they had realistic interests, that's technical interests that often achievers don't have. The underachievers were more introverted, more open to experience, less conscientious than achievers, okay? So more of that profile that we were looking for. But more is not always better. I'm not saying that we necessarily needed them to be achievers, but they also were more anxious and had a lot of problems. In values, they ranked mature love and wisdom as their highest values more often than achievers. Very idealistic group. But on the characteristic of absorption is a, most of you know, absorption is a characteristic, psychological characteristic that's related to attentional deployment. I like to think of it as the capacity to deliberately manage consciousness state, to deliberately and quickly and deftly go from alpha to beta to go into a trance state. These are the people who tell you, oh yeah, I love to dream, I can, you know, I know what's going on in my dreams. You guys are looking at each other. You know these people, they're just like float into these stages. much more. They seem to experience the world in a different way. Sometimes that was good. Sometimes we saw schizotypic behavior. So, like I said, it's not always a great thing, but for those who were able to self-regulate their emotions as well as their attentional deployment, then it was fine. So when we looked at who actually got it, so what about those kids that got into the gifted programs? These are what creative kids managed to get into creative programs. We looked at Torrance's early ideal student studies. And here's what we found out. We found out that the creative students had incredibly high variability. The average was quite high, but the range was from 0.2 to 4.0. Gender, work status, all these variables. Look at all those variables. None of them predicted selection into the gifted program. Only one variable significantly predicted selection into gifted education in high school. That was grade point average. Then we wanted to find out, yeah, but what predicted grade point average? The variable that was most commonly linked, intellectual ability, was not considered because we already knew that was there. And we found out that female students were more likely to have high GPAs. Students with high extroversion, high conscientiousness, and lower openness to experience, high social interest, low scientific and technical interest, and negative values for prosperity, didn't care about money, and positive values for physical health. Gee, who does that sound like? Ah, let me give it to you. Sounds like teachers. The students whose personalities resemble teachers the most are most likely to be selected into the gifted programs. So what happens to the creative students who don't fit the ideal? Uneven grades and achievement tests make acceptance to an elite college unlikely. Merit-based scholarships are unattainable. Community college may not be challenging enough unless they find a teacher like this. Public universities may be too large to find creative community. College town casualties hang out in low-wage jobs. A lot of these kids go to college for a while in a college town like Athens, and then they drop out and they just hang out because it's easy. It's easy just to hang out and not go anywhere. Creative skills without master teachers and practice deteriorate, and that's when we begin to see depression, substance abuse, and anxiety more likely. So now we're talking about the kids who don't fit the ideal, who don't get the special perks that go along with being the ideal student. And that's why we created the Makerspace. I got involved. My collaborator, my co-founder, got involved because he is a former project director for NASA, who first loves to put together projects, and second is interested in individual economic development and entrepreneurship. So he and I and a couple of artists got together, and we discovered, having dinner together at Wheatfields, that's the local hangout for creative people, we talked about what we wanted to do. And I told them, look, I've got all these creative kids who are just hanging around Lawrence. They're not going anywhere. Well, I want to do something for the adolescents, the young adults, and just the people in the community who aren't getting anywhere, but who are incredibly creative, and we've got lots of them. And we came up with the idea of having a makerspace. Now, this was 4 years ago when we first came up with the idea, and the maker movement was very young. The maker movement is a movement. If you don't know about it, Google it, because now there's 4,000 around the world. These are spaces for creative people. It emphasizes do-it-yourself careers, creating your own occupation. It provides a supportive environment for creative people. It tends to be non-hierarchical. Like, I keep struggling for words for Eric and me. They call us co-founders. They call me Maker Mama and him Maker Daddy. But we're not directors. You know, people ask us when we're filling out a form, you know, who's the president of your corporation? We go, who's your officer? Who's your treasurer? Well, we kind of share all those jobs. They're extremely non-hierarchical. Most makerspaces are very flat in organizational structure. They tend to be collaborative, and that is the emphasis upon getting together with other people and creating projects together. And they're open. And by open, I mean we say yes. Somebody comes in and says, okay, I heard you guys had this brain hacking thing where you're using headsets, EEG headsets, to control light and sound. I want to control drones. okay? I want to control quadcopters. And we say, yes! As long as it doesn't hurt anybody. We always say there can't be any limb loss. But yes, they tend to be, they provide tools, equipment, and training. And we started out without anything, asked for donations, and the wood shop was complete within weeks, as was the metal shop, as was the glass shop. Hey, old people are dying all the time and leaving behind workshops, okay? And there, and you know, we would like hang around estate sales and go, well, if that doesn't sell, contact us. You know, like vultures. And we filled up with equipment. We had 3D printers. The university donated 20 computers to begin with because they send them to the landfill otherwise. These kind of spaces encourage risk-taking and entrepreneurship. We bring in people from the Kauffman Foundation to talk about that. I have groups with the artists to talk about how to present your work. We talk with inventors about how to build a prototype. We provide a place to work and a place to display products. And you'll see about that. Now, some of you may have heard of STEAM Labs. That science stands for Science, Technology, Engineering, Arts, and Mathematics. STEAM Labs are more likely to be in academic settings, often in the School of Engineering. They are more formal in structure, meaning that there's a person who's designated by the provost to be the head of it or by the dean of engineering, and that there's a structure and that there's lots of rules around who gets to use the equipment, which is the main reason we start Makerspaces, because what we say is, do you want to be able to use expensive, dangerous equipment? You know, we'd like you to be able to. By the way, a maker in the making was the 4-year-old son of one of my creative colleagues. All the time he was little, he'd look at toys and she'd say, no, look at that on the package. You can't have that. That's a choking hazard. So, you know, 3 and under, can't have it. Choking hazard. So he turns 4. She says, what do you want for your birthday? He said, I would like a lot of choking hazards. Okay, those grown-up kids are the ones who want to have a makerspace. They want to work with expensive, dangerous equipment. So STEAM Labs do a lot of what makerspaces do, but like I said, they tend to be a little more organized. Not my thing. So now I'll just show you what a makerspace feels like. That's George Paley, who was a sculptor and a downtown businessman who first started looking for gallery spaces 4 years ago. And it was only when he came together with our group, he was savvy and he knew where the buildings were that we could rent. It was wonderful. So that brings us back to the mission and how we've tried to integrate finding, guiding, gathering, and placemaking to deal with the needs of adolescent and young adults of all types. I know that all of us would like to see our creative young people, you know, going on to prestigious or elite universities and going on to achieve eminence, but they're not all gonna go there, okay? If we can just help them be economic, if we can help them to survive and do their work and live their passion, we're really happy about that. So, that's it, and thank you so much. Comments?
So what
you get. I'm sorry.
Do you think this concept will spread around the country? And is there anything going on that would take it to different places? I'm thinking different countries.
There are now 4,000 around the world. And the world's largest maker fair just took place in Berlin. And before that, the largest maker fair was in San Francisco. But they are all over the place. Make magazine, the August issue, had a list of the makerspaces at this point, and online. If you go to make.org, I think it is, it'll list all the makerspaces everywhere. And by the way, after just 6 months, we were named one of the 25 most interesting makerspaces in the world. Is that fun, out of those thousands? So it's amazing how fast they grow and how fast it's expanding around the world. Maker fairs draw thousands of people and become huge in convention centers. Kansas City, they had 40,000 people come to the Maker Fair that was held in the big train station, made a lot of money for the city. So yeah, cities like this.
And they are starting in schools too, and yes, elementary schools, and like they're changing lives with yours. I'm like weeping with your work, but when they're in elementary schools, they find these children any of their age, and they call them a slave.
Wonderful. I do want to mention that NSF, DOD, and a number of foundations have funding for building makerspaces in schools. So I don't want to poo-poo that. Believe me, I'm happy to take that money for my projects. But in this case, we wanted the independence to experiment and do things that were different. But makerspaces are wonderful additions to schools because it's a place for the creative kids. It's not like art lessons where it's structured, where they have to do this particular thing. They just go in and start making.
So how old is your population? I mean, who's in there?
Well, we have the family rate, and so a lot of like little kids will come, especially for robotics. What's up with that? They love robotics. Little kids and their families, ranging from that all the way to very elderly, retired. We had a bunch of old ex-Marines come in who heard about us at the VFW, and they have all these skills. They've been teaching wood shop to the kids, and metal shop, and optics. Is that where you grind lenses and stuff? Yeah. So yeah, these guys, so from really young to old. I want to be honest and say, at first we had a gender issue, okay? It was, do you see those early pictures? Me and 30 guys? Okay, like fun for me, not such a good thing. So what we discovered is that there really is gender segregation in making. There is no difference in spatial visual skills between a textile artist and a person who does, you know, work with welding or software sorts of things. There's not that much difference, okay? They're gendered. So what we did is we who has, when women come in, first we'd love bomb them, not sexual harassment kind of thing. But I mean, it's like, oh my gosh, we're so glad you're here. But then we reached out to textile artists, we reached out to artists, we reached out to women, and then when they said, oh, well, we should have a fine arts group, meaning we're not comfortable with all the horsing around of the guys, you know, we really discouraged that segregation by talking about it openly and saying, we want to be diverse, right? Not to mention people of color are overrepresented at our makerspace, and that's not true of most makerspaces. So that's because we made an effort to get out into the community. Yes?
I want to interrupt to say I don't want to run it too much over the time, but those of you, I know you have a lot of questions. If you would write them down, and just after lunch, we're going to have some collaboration
Thank
time.
You.
And then we can
Sorry to run over. I just get all enthusiastic.
Thank you.